Hello and welcome to my series of conversations with men and women as ideas, vision and philosophy help define our contemporary world. My guest today is one of India's most preeminent, distinguished legal luminaries. He's been described as a public-spirited nationalist by the Prime Minister during the recent release of his autobiography, Maverick with a Conscience. He's been a distinguished parliamentarian for more than 20 years and an upholder of lost causes. I'm delighted to welcome Mr. Ram Jethmalani. Maverick, you've described yourself as a maverick. What did you mean by that? Why do you describe yourself as a maverick?
Well, frankly, it's not how I described myself, how my friends described me. And I don't demur. A maverick is a person who is not attached to any particular dogma, nor does he mortgage his conscience or his intellect to any political party or even to any political doctrine. I'm an old Benthamite, you know, and I believe that the greatest happiness of the greatest number is the only fundamental principle of governance, principle of legislation, and principle of morality.
Yet you sort of brought in the title of your book, The Conscience Too. Were you concerned that people don't normally associate a maverick with a conscience?
On the contrary. Maverick is one who only speaks according to conscience and does not allow his conscience either to be controlled or at least in a sense diluted or corrupted by any extraneous factors.
What is the sort of the basis of conscience for you? You've talked about the greatest happiness of the largest number.
Take a simple example. I have never changed a political party. There's a common impression that I've gone through the whole spectrum of political parties in this country. That's all utter rubbish. I have never once changed a political party to achieve for myself any particular political or social advantage, any advantage of any kind. I was in the Janata Party. Now, the Janata Party came into existence as a result of the emergency. I was opposed to the emergency. I'm a person who believes in constitutional liberty. I was a congressman all my life. Throughout the freedom movement, I had been a congressman, and everybody almost was in this country. But I parted company with the Congress when it degenerated. All right, so I joined the Janata. The Janata itself fell foul of its own ideals. And you saw how it disintegrated within 2.5 years. And out of it came a Janata party which Mr. Subramaniam Swamy has taken over.
And he was not very kind to you, to put it mildly.
But I thought that the BJP which came into existence, they were the wronged party according to me. I believe that people raised those dual membership issues and so on and so forth. They wanted somehow to bring down the Janata government. That was the long and short of it. So I joined the BJP not because it represented the politics of Janasangha, but I thought that they had genuinely adopted the Janata philosophy and the Janata's manifesto and the Janata's even economic doctrines. And so I said, well, at least they have been the wronged party in this partition. So I was with them. And I remained there in that party until I was thrown out. And I was thrown out not because I was flirting with another party, but because I was doing my political and professional duty.
And the Chief Justice of India.
To defend. I took up the defense of people who had been sentenced to death as a result of the conviction in that murder trial of Srimati Indira Gandhi herself. So they threw me out. I was again true to my own conscience. I know that I had to perform. And mind you, it was not an engagement which in any sense brought me any money. It was free. I was requested by the High Court to argue the appeal of a man who had been sentenced to death. It is the tradition of our profession that it is regarded as the highest ethical and professional duty of a lawyer is to do this kind of free work.
You have consistently opposed the death penalty for your clients and as...
I must tell you that I am basically opposed to the death penalty, but I have always wondered that there is one classic situation in which it is very difficult to say that the death penalty should not be awarded. And that case I have often discussed publicly. That's the case of a person who is undergoing a sentence of life imprisonment for a previous murder, and without provocation and a very callous manner, he kills his jail warden. What punishment do you give him? That's one situation where I have said, my God, probably society can't do without inflicting a death sentence.
Have you sort of in defending people who in the public perception are already guilty, has it ever come up for you that you have been convinced perhaps that they are not guilty and it is your job as a lawyer to defend them?
I will tell you, for a long time in my professional career, that moral dilemma never troubled me at all, because we were brought up in what is called the adversarial system of criminal justice, in which a lawyer is not supposed to act on his own opinion about the guilt of an accused person. That's a matter for the judge to decide. You are supposed to represent the client's case as effectively and ably as you can. The whole philosophy of the adversarial system is that when two persons ranged on opposite sides do their best to present their respective cases, that's the best chance of truth emerging in the mind of the judge. So a lawyer usurps the judicial function to the prejudice of his own client. And what means have I of determining the truth? Supposing I find a case in which five persons have said that this man did the killing. My client tells me when I meet him that, sir, all these five persons are my enemies, and you just cross-examine them and you will find out that they are all liars. Now, how do I decide this conundrum?
Well, you know, at least in the movies it happens that the lawyer will say to his client, look, tell me the truth so that I can try and get you the best possible deal.
I'm glad you talked of the movies. That life is not governed by what happens in the movies. Movies are unrealistic. We have an express rule framed by the Bar Council of India, a rule, if you breach it, you are liable to be dealt with for professional misconduct and your right to practice can be taken away. That rule says that no lawyer shall refuse to defend a person on the ground that he believes him to be guilty or that the accused is so unpopular that it will affect his own reputation and popularity.
Do you think this is a fair limitation?
It's a very fair rule. Because the other alternative is the Soviet system and that is no system. I mean, that's an evil system where everybody comes and pleads guilty in court. Where they have been subjected to so much of psychosomatic pressure that people have pleaded guilty to offenses which they never committed.
You've come under a lot of flack for several cases that you've taken on, and most recently, of course, the Manu Sharma case. Without going into going over familiar territory again, what were your motives? Why did you take on what was an obviously unpopular case? Your family was opposed to it.
My motive is my professional obligation. So long as I belong to that profession, I must live by its rules. I can't say that in a particular case I won't follow the rule because the press believes my client to be guilty. But I told you, this never bothered me at one time.
Does it bother you now?
Now I do sit in judgment over my clients because I'm winding up my practice and I want to take very little work, and the little work that I take is usually free work. And I do it under tremendous social pressure. I do it. So therefore, at least now I feel qualified in to some extent sitting in judgment over my client. There are some cases which probably I will not take up because of my own personal opinions about this. But the more the people oppose my
the greater your
freedom,
resolve.
Yeah. That puts me up. That puts me up. Then I said, all right, to hell with you. I'm I am anyway doing my professional duty. And it is my duty to tell the court that this is the evidence, these are the defects in the evidence, this is where the law has not been followed. And it's for the judge to decide. I do nothing wrong.
You're watching a conversation with the preeminent legal luminary Ram Jethmalani. We'll be right back after a short break. Don't go away. Welcome back to a continuing conversation with the legal luminary Ram Jethmalani. Has it happened that, at the end of a case, when the evidence has been processed and presented, that you have felt convinced that someone guilty has gotten off? Privately?
Yes.
And then how do you feel?
Yes, I have.
Then how do you feel?
I have, but I will tell you, a guilty person might have got off. The law which says that nobody shall be convicted without convincing evidence has been upheld. So every case is a affirmation and a vindication of the fundamental principle of justice that nobody should be convicted without evidence. And when I say that he is guilty and the guilty man has got off, I am again interposing my personal opinion, which I have no right to do. My client, assuming it is a paid client, I mean, he's entitled to turn at me, I mean, look at me with contempt and say, listen, judge or lawyer, I am paying you for your professional work and not for your opinion. I didn't come to you for an opinion.
You know, the Prime Minister, while releasing your book, talked about this wonderful synthesis of head and heart. So this is obviously the kind of case where, the head and heart in some ways in conflict. And you seem to be...
My head and heart are not in conflict with each other, but my head and heart are often in conflict with the head and heart of others.
But in a case like this, where in your heart you know a rapist or criminal or a smuggler...
A rapist is not a rapist until the last court has found him to be a rapist. This has happened to me in the past. I mean, you are talking of Jessica Lal case. I remember...
That's another one.
The Sharda case. I am talking of the 80s, where a young engineer was supposed to have killed his wife by poisoning her because he had a girlfriend. Now there was so much pain, and he had been sentenced to death. And it is at that stage that I was engaged. Now that was not a free case, that was an ordinary professional engagement. And I took it up. And I remember that women's delegations used to come from all over, from Pune particularly. And then one day I had to sit and argue with this whole delegation of women. I told them, I said, please keep your hand here and put yourself in the position of a mother of this accused who has been sentenced to death. Will you be seeking a lawyer or no? And if a lawyer tells you that I won't appear, what will you think of that lawyer? Ultimately they left me alone. And mind you, I argued the case in the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court held that the case was false. And the civil surgeon who had given evidence, the court ordered his prosecution. Now, an innocent man would have gone to gallows.
You seem to have sort of this, all our conversations so far, this deep, profound, implicit faith in the systems and processes of the law, and your job to sustain and preserve.
No, but I'm telling you, it is true that some parts of the law are technical. But the technicalities operate more on the civil side than on the criminal side. On the criminal side, true that we don't accept confessions which are made to the police because the society still does not believe the veracity and honesty of our police officer. And I think their society is quite justified in not imposing implicit trust. But in every case, you'll have a confession. Recently, it has been reported in the press, the fellow whose confession was taken, I think he was made to plead guilty to a charge of possession of narcotics and given 10 years. And the High Court of Bombay and the Supreme Court both came to the conclusion that this confession was extorted by torture, so much of torture that the man's foot had been practically disabled for all time. And it was such a cruel, cruel case, and they had not one word of evidence other than his confession.
But yet, in the United States, recently there was a report that, of a group that went into DNA testing of people on death row and found such
how
a
many,
large percentage of people.
How many people have been now let off because the DNA evidence has shown that they were wrongly convicted? But why do you talk of DNA? Talk of Irish terrorists who were convicted some 15 years ago by a jury in England, and evidence turned up later on that the prosecution witnesses and particularly the police officer had lied.
Sir, but doesn't it contradict what you're saying? Because in a sense, there must be many innocent people who were also, through these due processes of law, who will have received and the death penalty will
have
been implemented.
That's what has happened. So, human
how do you maintain this
human
faith in
justice
the system?
Is fallible. It will remain fallible. The highest integrity and honesty of our judges and even experience of our judges, they would still commit mistakes and send innocent people to gallows.
Are you ever conscious of your fallibility perhaps? And in what ways do you fear it most?
Greatly, but my fallibility doesn't hurt anyone. The judge's fallibility does, but mine does not.
Well, implicitly, if you defend...
My fallibility is in the sense that if I can't defend a person properly, he may still suffer. But that has a very, very, very small impact. I mean, there may be a rare case, but at least I don't know in my own experience that because of my failure to defend properly, somebody got convicted.
You mentioned the sort of the greatest happiness of the largest numbers as being one of your goals. What is happiness to you? What makes you happy? What do you understand by being
well,
happy?
Well, I will tell you what makes me happy. There are two ways of looking at things. Anything which produces even physical pleasure, according to me, is a part of happiness. And therefore, I don't look askance at physical activity which is productive of pleasure in the purely physical sense, the tactile sense. I consider that moral. So long as in the net balance sheet, there is not a debit item of its producing misery, either for me or for somebody else. One. Second, with your intellectual refinement, you find pleasure in things other than sensual. Today, if you ask me, and I am a student of religion, I have studied a lot about all religions, but ultimately I have come to one sad conclusion that religion has a very bad balance sheet. It has produced more harm, more violence, more bloodshed, more conflict, then it has produced good. It has produced good for some people. It has become a system of solace and some people have found new hope in life and so on. All that I grant, but it has produced much greater evil. Therefore, I have reduced my entire religious sense to one simple, one sentence religion that make as many people happy as possible in your life. Reduce the sum total of human happiness to the extent to which it is possible for you. Today, that gives me the greatest happiness.
You're watching a conversation with Ram Jethmalani, public-spirited nationalist as described by the Prime Minister. We'll be right back after a short break. Don't go away. You're watching a conversation with Ram Jethmalani, public-spirited nationalist. You've been described as this public-spirited nationalist. Isn't in some ways in a globalized, interdependent world, the whole idea of nationalism needs to diminish somewhat?
Of course, there's no doubt about it. Sorry to digress from here. You know, when I became a lawyer, I went to a senior for blessing.
Well, I should interrupt and just sort of share with our viewers that you became a lawyer at the age of 17, when you weren't, you know, you would not ordinarily be qualified to practice in the bar. And you got the Chief Justice at that point to make an exception in your case, and you entered at that very young age.
Yes, and they made me even then wait for 1 year and said at least become a major.
Sorry, I interrupted you, so you were telling me.
But I tell you, I sought advice from a senior, you know, went to him for blessing, and he gave me three bits of advice. Each one is worth recall. He said, you know, Ram, a time will come when you will lose a case, but so conduct yourself that you don't lose your client. at least have his confidence that you have done your best for him. He says, but I grant that you will have a situation in which you lose the case, perhaps the client too, but don't lose the court, the trust of the court that he is a fair lawyer, he will not mislead the court and so on. The last part of his advice was the best advice that I have ever got, that you may lose a case, a client and the court, but don't lose your conscience. Now that's where the conscience of a maverick comes in. Now you extrapolate it to the field in which you ask that question. I believe that a man of conscience should be able to tell his nation that you are wrong, that what you are doing may be good for you in the short run, but you are causing great, great, great damage to the world as a whole. And therefore you are right that that nationalism by itself is a very inadequate star to which you hitch your wagon.
You've stood up for so many principles, so many causes, and you know the aspect of the heart. Is the heart of Ram Jethmalani occasionally hurt that people misunderstand you, that people don't see where you're coming from, what you're reaching out to?
Well, it does cause me some temporary hurt, but not for long. When I say God, please pardon me, I speak with my tongue in the cheek. I give God the benefit of doubt. I'm not 100% sure that he exists in the form in which we normally conceive of God.
No, do you experience pain when somebody is unduly harsh?
Something in me makes me forget my enemies. I don't remember who has harmed me in life. Some people have reminded me, my juniors for example, he said, only last week this man abused you. I had forgotten it. So this capacity to forget the wrongs done to you by others is a great asset. I am not capable of entertaining malice or sustained hatred against the worst people who have tried to harm me. If a person who has harmed me comes to me for help, I consider that I have won. He is the one who has been defeated, that has ultimately come to me for my help, and I go out of my way to help those who have hurt me. And that is a great source of joy.
The times that you have been in government, that you have been a minister, has that felt in some ways like perhaps a compromise with the system? You said you wanted to brill in need, or it was desirable to seek the confidence of the court.
I'm a student of the Constitution. Our judges in the Supreme Court have long ago, from 75 onwards, created the principle of transparency of a democratic government, the people's right to know. Now it arises out of the Constitution. When I became an urban development minister, I made an announcement that you pay 10 rupees and come and examine any file that you like in my office, and we'll be supplied all information.
The precursor to the right to information.
And this day, my whole cabinet, the prime minister, the cabinet secretary came to me with great panic that what have you done and so on. I said, listen, what I have done is the right thing to do. People have a right to know. We are their servants of the people. We are not their masters that we can keep secrets from them. He says, no, but we are now thinking of the Right to Information Act. I said, the Information Act will only create a mechanism. The obligation already has been created by the judgments of under the Constitution. So I can't wait till you enact your law. Ultimately, they removed me from that ministry.
You know, for an icon such as yourself, to a lot of young lawyers, to a lot of the flag bearers for lost causes, who are some of your own icons, people that you celebrate and that you would still look up to? Are there living people?
I've had some people in my life. For example, early in my life, I started my practice in Karachi, in Pakistan. I started in 1941, and my icon at that time was a Muslim gentleman, Mr. A.K. Broi, who soon after the partition of India became a law minister in Pakistan.
Any living people that you would, any living people that you would celebrate and say that, well, that's a good man?
Well, I have picked up bits from everybody. Bits from everybody, but not that there has been a person who wholesale has appealed to me and I have become a complete follower. No.
Well, who are some of these people that you would point to and say, he's a good man, an honorable man?
Now, for example, yes.
Who are some of the people?
For example, my contact with Mr. Sirwai, the Advocate General of Bombay at one time. According to me, he was a model of integrity. So I picked up some tenets of my professional conduct from
him. I'm sorry to push you, but anyone currently active that you would celebrate in some way, not in their totality? Or is that something you find difficult to?
Frankly, I'm sorry to disappoint you. No, I really can't. There are people who, for example, I'm a great admirer of the Prime Minister. Why? Because I believe in his integrity, and which is a very rare kind of a qualification these days. And you see what is happening all around us. But I won't say that everything that the Prime Minister does or says is like gospel to me. No. At one time, I would judge of the morality of an action by what my friend Mr. Brohi would think of it. If he said it is moral, it is moral. If he says it is immoral, it is immoral.
After a lifetime of struggling for justice, for truth, for promoting the happiness of the largest number of people, you know, from the depths of your heart, do you finally, at this stage in your life, and it's not the final stages of your life, do you despair at the manner in which the world around you is unfolding? Or is there hope?
Well, I personally think that in that sense, I have not been a successful person. I admit that I have failed in my major concerns.
But you did your best.
On the other hand...
But don't you have the satisfaction that you did your best?
That satisfaction is that I did my best. Maybe I could have done better. Maybe. But I have done my best. I have done my little bit. I hope there are some people who have at least profited from my example. That's all that I can hope for. And but I don't think that I'm satisfied with the way things are. My fight has been mainly against political corruption. I don't think I have succeeded to any significant extent. I get more and more evidence of corruption, and in higher and higher places. So it's a disappointment in a way. But it's given to a mortal only to do his best.
Thank you very much, sir. This has been truly inspiring and a wonderful opportunity.
My pleasure.
Thank you very much, sir.
A pleasure.